Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper by looking at an article from the front page of the Delhi edition. India to decide on Iran crude imports after polls. We have been closely tracking the ongoing tensions between US and Iran and its likely impact on India's energy security. So as a part of these developments, the Iranian foreign minister has visited India in order to update the government of India about the ongoing developments in the Persian Gulf. Tensions have been increasing in the Persian Gulf ever since the United States quit the Iran nuclear deal, which was signed in 2015. This deal is also referred to as the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, and the United States decided to quit the agreement, and it has decided to reimpose economic sanctions targeted against the banking sector and the oil sector of Iran. And as a part of these economic sanctions, the US is expecting all the countries to cut banking transactions with Iran, and it is expecting all the countries to zero out oil imports from Iran. These sanctions were reimposed by the United States in 2018, and it had given a 6-month extension for few countries, including India, which are extremely dependent on Iranian crude oil. This deadline expired on the 2nd of May, and since then, the US is expecting all the countries to zero out Iranian oil imports. So the reimposition of economic sanctions by the US threatens the economic stability of Iran, and it also threatens the energy security of various countries, including India. And the problem for India is that Iran is one of the top suppliers of crude oil. According to data available for 2018-19, Iran was supplying around 10% of India's crude oil requirement. You can clearly see that Iranian crude oil plays a very important role in ensuring India's energy security. And you can see a chart over here. This can be very, very important for prelims. It shows the top suppliers of crude oil to India for the period 2011 to 2019. The highest supplier is Saudi Arabia. Then we have Iraq, Venezuela, Iran, Nigeria, United Arab Emirates, Kuwait, Angola, Mexico, and Qatar. And if you look at these top 5 suppliers, at least 3 out of these 5 countries are going through some sort of crisis, and this poses a direct threat to India's energy security. Basically, geopolitical developments and domestic developments within these countries is having a direct impact on India's energy security. Iraq is yet to recover from the impact of the American war and the rise of the Islamic State. Venezuela is going through a domestic political crisis, and Iran is facing increased tensions with the United States because of the reimposition of the sanctions over Iran's nuclear program. So in the middle of these developments, the Iranian foreign minister has visited India in order to update the government of India on the ongoing developments. He has assured India that Iran can be a reliable partner in ensuring India's energy security. He has assured that Iran plays a very crucial role in ensuring India's connectivity to Afghanistan and Central Asia. And the Iranian government has blamed the United States for the ongoing tensions in the Persian Gulf. But the Indian government has said it can take a concrete decision on this issue only after the elections are completed and only after a new government is in place after the 23rd of May. Now let's take up the next article. Private weather forecasting agency SkyMet has released its assessment of the upcoming southwest monsoon season. And according to these estimates, the onset of southwest monsoon over Kerala is likely to take place on the 4th of June. So this would mean that the onset has been delayed by at least 3 days, because June 1st is ideally considered to be the date of onset of monsoons over Kerala. So in this context, let us understand the movement of southwest monsoon over the Indian subcontinent. This map shows the advance estimates for southwest monsoon for 2019, which was released by SkyMet a few months earlier. But right now, the estimates have been revised and the dates have been delayed. You can see that according to earlier estimates, the southwest monsoon was supposed to make onset over Kerala on the 1st of June. Right now it has been delayed, and the revised estimates suggest that it is likely to make onset on the 4th of June. So this makes Kerala the first state in India to receive the southwest monsoon winds. But the first location in India to receive southwest monsoon is not the state of Kerala, but it is the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. You can see that the monsoons were expected to arrive on the 20th of May. Right now, this estimate has been delayed to the 22nd of May. So this part of the monsoon winds, which brings rainfall to Sri Lanka and Andaman Nicobar Islands, will proceed further to bring rainfall to Myanmar and as well as Thailand. And the monsoons which arrive in Kerala will bring heavy rainfall to the Western Ghats region. It will pass over to the rain shadow areas, and it will proceed over interior Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh, and it will also make onset in the northeast of India on the very same day. A few days later, the monsoons will arrive over the Western Ghats of Goa and Karnataka as well. It will bring very heavy rainfall to the coastal areas of Karnataka and Goa, and then it will proceed to the rain shadow areas of interior Karnataka, Telangana, Andhra Pradesh and Maharashtra. This will proceed further to bring rainfall to the eastern parts of India, and it will also proceed to reach the northeastern parts of India. But please remember that there is a rain shadow area in Tamil Nadu which does not receive any rainfall during the southwest monsoon. This rain shadow region of Tamil Nadu will receive rainfall only when the monsoon makes a retreat, and after a few days, the monsoons will arrive over Maharashtra and parts of Gujarat. It will proceed over central parts of India. It will reach the eastern states, that is Chhattisgarh, Odisha, etc. And it will proceed to cover Bihar, West Bengal and the remaining parts of northeast India. And a few days later, the monsoons will cover the state of Gujarat. It will cover the central Indian states of Madhya Pradesh and Uttar Pradesh. And the last region in India to receive the monsoon winds is the northwest of India. This includes Rajasthan, Delhi, Punjab, Haryana and parts of Jammu and Kashmir. So this movement of monsoons over the Indian subcontinent can be very important for prelims. You can expect a geography question on these lines. Now let us quickly look at the estimates that SkyMet has provided for 2019. According to the revised estimates of SkyMet, the southwest monsoon is likely to set in over Kerala on the 4th of June. Basically, it has been delayed by 3 days. And it will make onset over the Andaman and Nicobar Islands on the 22nd of May. And on the 4th of June itself, the monsoon winds will reach few parts of northeast India as well. And the estimates for the overall season suggest that the eastern parts of India, the northeastern parts of India and the central parts of India, they are likely to receive lesser than normal rainfall as compared to the northwestern parts of India and the southern peninsula, which is expected to receive normal or above normal rainfall. And the estimates also suggest that the rice bowl of India, that is represented by the central parts of India, is expected to receive the lowest rainfall in the region. But the eastern states, such as Odisha and Chhattisgarh, they are expected to receive above normal rainfall, whereas the semi-arid regions of Maharashtra, that is Vidarbha and Marathwada, including few western parts of Madhya Pradesh and Gujarat, they are expected to receive below average rainfall. And finally, the article tries to provide an explanation for the delay in the onset of monsoons. The Indian Meteorological Department is expected to release its assessment today, and some of its officials are of the opinion that the normal date of arrival is the 1st of June. But it has been delayed by 3 days to the 4th of June, most likely because of the impact of El Nino. El Nino is an abnormal weather condition which is reported near the coast of Peru. There is a higher than normal temperature reported in the central and eastern equatorial Pacific, which can have an impact on the arrival of monsoons in India. And the experts of IMD also believe that the higher than normal temperatures which are being registered in the Bay of Bengal could also be one of the reasons behind the delay in the onset of monsoons over Kerala. So these two factors could be responsible for the delay in the arrival of monsoons, but this does not indicate the performance of the southwest monsoon over the entire season, Because over the last 40 years, monsoons have arrived on the expected date only three times since 1971. Since 1971, the monsoons have arrived on the 1st of June only three times, which means that the delay in its onset is not an indication for its performance over the entire season. Now let's take up the next article. Sri Lanka blast accused were on the radar of Indian agencies. And the Indian agencies believe that three Islamic State suspects in India were in touch with these accused, and these suspects have been recently charge-sheeted by the National Investigation Agency. And according to the NIA and the Gujarat Anti-Terrorist Squad, they were planning to carry out a lone wolf attack in India. So in this context, we need to understand what is a lone wolf attack. A lone wolf attack refers to a terrorist act carried out by an individual or by a lone terrorist who is acting outside the command structure of a terror outfit. He wouldn't have received any financial support or logistical support from this terror group. He essentially doesn't have any affiliation with the terror outfit. So despite having no direct affiliation to the terror outfit, few individuals might be motivated to carry out a terror attack on behalf of the group. Basically, these are individuals who would be influenced or motivated by the radical ideology and beliefs which are propagated by a terror outfit. We have seen quite a few lone wolf attacks which have been carried out on the behalf of the Islamic State, and most of these incidents have taken place against European cities. European cities such as Paris, London, Berlin, Amsterdam, they have been targeted by such lone terrorists who were influenced by the ideology of the Islamic State. And these individuals would have no direct affiliation with the Islamic State. They would have never received any training or any financial support from the terror group. They wouldn't even have traveled to Iraq or Syria to fight on behalf of the Islamic State. So some of these individuals, they are largely self-radicalized through the internet, and they have been self-motivated to carry out terror attacks on behalf of the Islamic State. We have seen attacks wherein an individual has organized his own finances in order to acquire weapons and build a bomb. We have even seen incidents where individuals motivated by ISIS ideology have carried out knife attacks, and they have claimed that they were acting on behalf of the Islamic State. We have also seen lone terrorists driving a truck or a bus into a crowded area with the intention of carrying out a terrorist act on behalf of the ISIS. So such individual acts of terrorism is referred to as lone wolf attacks. Next, we have two articles on page 1 and page 13, which deals with India's relations with the WTO. And according to this article, India has labeled the STR index of WTO to be flawed and biased. The STR index stands for Services Trade Restrictiveness Index, and it was developed by the OECD. And according to India, the methodology used by the index is flawed, and it has a positive bias towards the developed countries, whereas it has a negative bias towards the developing countries. The STR index was developed by the OECD, and it was launched by the WTO in 2014 in order to measure the extent of restrictiveness with regard to trade and services amongst 45 countries which are part of the WTO. This includes 36 members of OECD and the 9 non-OECD members. And according to the recently published STR index, India has been ranked very high in terms of restrictiveness. This is quite funny and ironic because India is one amongst the few countries which has provided for maximum liberalization with regard to FDI in trade in services. So in order to identify these flaws and point out the bias, the Ministry of Commerce had commissioned a study to evaluate the functioning of the STR index. According to the study group, the methodology adopted by OECD is entirely flawed, and it displays a clear bias against the developing countries. And this study group has even come up with an alternative mechanism to measure restrictiveness in various countries. And India has recently approached like-minded countries such as China, Brazil, Indonesia, Turkey, and South Africa in order to gain support for the alternative index that India has developed. So now let us look at a few basic facts about the OECD, which can be important for prelims. OECD stands for the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. It was established in 1961 and it currently consists of 36 member countries. Its main objective is to promote economic progress and world trade. And the precondition to be a member of OECD is that the country should be a democratic country and it should believe in capitalism and in a market-based economy. So this organization provides a platform for the member countries to coordinate over domestic and international policy issues. The platform is also used to resolve global economic problems and encourage the adoption of best practices. If you look at the member states, they all belong to the high income category. They all have very high human development index and they are regarded as developed countries. So this organization, which is headquartered in Paris, consists of 36 members and most of them are from Europe. Most European countries are members of the OECD and it also includes other developed economies such as United States, Canada, Japan, South Korea, Australia and New Zealand. Now let's take up the next article. The Ministry of Agriculture has decided to use latest technology in order to estimate crop yield. Estimation of crop yield is very important for settling insurance claims and provide for adequate compensation due to crop failure and natural disasters. But the current method used for crop yield estimation, which is known as crop cutting experiments, is highly inaccurate and it is time consuming and highly complicated. In a crop cutting experiment, a small patch of land measuring around 5x5 meters is selected and a particular crop is grown in this small patch of land. Later, the crop is harvested and the weight of the produce is measured. And this sampling data is extrapolated from this experiment and it is projected to a much larger area such as 1 acre of land. So basically, by using the sampling data in a small patch of land, the data is projected to provide an estimation for a larger agricultural area. So this method is not only inaccurate, but it can be highly time-consuming and complicated because under the Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana, at least 4 crop cutting experiments have to be carried out at the Gram Panchayat level. So this is resulting in delays while settling insurance claims for farmers and in providing compensation to the farmers during crop failure and disasters. In order to overcome this challenge, the Ministry of Agriculture had carried out a pilot project in 11 states during the Kharif season of 2018. It is also running this project during the ongoing Rabi season for 2019. In this pilot project, the Ministry of Agriculture has completely abandoned the crop cutting experiments and instead, it is bringing in advanced technology such as satellite data and remote sensing data through which the area of cultivation and the health of the crops can be measured. It is also using drones or unmanned aerial vehicles in combination with AI tools. And these platforms will be linked with IoT sensors which are deployed in the agricultural field to provide for an automated estimation of crop yield. Now let's take up the next article. The Supreme Court has ordered the demolition of few apartments in Kochi which had violated the norms of the Coastal Regulation Zone guidelines. The Supreme Court has observed that unregulated construction in eco-sensitive areas has affected the natural flow of water and this has had a devastating impact during natural disasters such as urban floods which have been recently witnessed in Tamil Nadu, in Kerala and as well as in Uttarakhand. So these disasters are no longer natural disasters. They are essentially man-made disasters which have been caused by unregulated construction activities. And this has resulted in massive loss of human life and property. And hence, the Supreme Court has directed the local authorities to ensure a strict enforcement of such regulations. Because under the Coastal Zone Management Plan, and as well as under the Section 3 of the Environment Protection Act of 1986, the responsibility of issuing building permits lies with the local authorities. So while issuing these building permits, the local authorities need to ensure that none of these regulations and guidelines are violated, and such a strict enforcement of the CRZ guidelines is in the interest of protecting the eco-sensitive coastal areas of India. The CRZ guidelines were first introduced in 2011 by the Ministry of Environment and Forest. It basically imposes a set of regulations with regard to construction, mining, tourism, etc. in the coastal areas. And later, the Shailesh Nayak Committee was also set up in order to review the existing regulations and update the CRZ notification. So based on these recommendations, a new set of guidelines have been issued in 2018. And we have covered the CRZ notification of 2018 in great detail in our 23rd Jan analysis. So kindly go back and watch this video for a complete understanding. Next, on the editorial page, we have a column written by Rakesh Sood, which refers to the ongoing tensions between US and Iran, and it also refers to the responsibility of the European countries in diffusing these tensions. The writer says that the West Asian region is riddled with multiple conflicts, including the ongoing conflict between Israel and Palestine. He also refers to the conflict created by the rise of the Islamic State and the subsequent involvement of the United States, Russia, Iran, and Turkey. He also refers to the ongoing civil war in Yemen, which is basically a proxy war between Saudi Arabia and Iran. So this is a list of some of the ongoing conflicts in West Asia, and the United States is looking very eager to add another conflict to this list. Since the last year, the United States is deliberately increasing tensions with Iran, and it has brought the two countries to the brink of conflict. These tensions began when Donald Trump decided to withdraw unilaterally from the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. This is also referred to as the Iran nuclear deal, which was signed in 2015, and this had reduced tensions between US and Iran. The signing of the nuclear deal was considered as a major diplomatic success for the Barack Obama government, and this was made possible due to the intervention of the European countries. The United Kingdom, France, and Germany had played a very big role in the signing of the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. This nuclear deal was signed between Iran and the P5 plus 1 countries and the European Union. The term P5 plus 1 refers to the 5 permanent members of the UN Security Council, and plus 1 refers to Germany. So as a part of this deal, Iran was expected to stop the production of highly enriched uranium and heavy water, which can be used in the production of nuclear weapons. And Iran was also expected to sell the existing stockpile of highly enriched uranium. And in return, the United States would remove the sanctions against Iran, and the European countries would assist Iran in rebuilding its economy. But last year, Donald Trump unilaterally withdrew from the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, and the US has reimposed economic sanctions against Iran, which has started crippling the Iranian economy. So Iran considers this not only as an economic threat, but as a major threat to its national security. Along with this, the US has adopted a number of hostile steps over the last few months, and it clearly shows that the US is deliberately increasing tensions with Iran in order to provoke an unnecessary conflict. For example, recently the United States has designated the armed forces of Iran, that is the IRGC, as a foreign terrorist group. And this designation of the IRGC as a foreign terrorist outfit will complicate Iran's relations with the Financial Action Task Force, and the FATF might take certain action against Iran. This will further cripple the Iranian economy, and hence Iran sees this as a hostile move by the United States. And over the last weeks, it has been noticed that the US is increasing its military deployment around the Persian Gulf. It has pushed an aircraft carrier battle group along with the B-52 bombers into the Persian Gulf, and this is seen as a direct threat against Iran. So Iran has responded to these hostile actions of the United States by declaring the US armed forces as a terrorist outfit, and it has issued a final warning to the European countries to ensure that the European countries will exert diplomatic pressure on the United States in order to force the US to reduce tensions with Iran. Iran also expects the European countries and as well as Russia and China to uphold the commitments of the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. And Iran has also threatened that if these countries do not uphold the Iran nuclear deal and exert pressure on the US, Iran will also walk out of the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. And Iran has said that it will start producing highly enriched uranium and heavy water, which can be used in the development of nuclear weapons. So based on this threat, if Iran violates the terms of the nuclear deal, the United States might be pushed into a conflict with Iran. And this is a very dangerous proposition for West Asia and as well as the entire world. Because any conflict between US and Iran will send shockwaves across the global oil markets, and it will have a very significant impact on global geopolitics. So the writer says that the European countries, especially UK, France and Germany, they have a very big responsibility over here to ensure that they exert diplomatic pressure on the US to scale back tensions with Iran. And at the same time, they need to reassure the Iranian government that they will uphold the commitments under the Iran nuclear deal. Next, we have a related article on page 12, which highlights the updated military plans of the United States to attack Iran if Iran resumes work on nuclear weapons or if Iran carries out a major attack against American interests in the West Asian region. According to reports, the Pentagon has finalized few plans to deploy around 120,000 troops into the region in order to be prepared for a conflict with Iran. And the US has already deployed a couple of aircraft carriers near the Persian Gulf. This includes USS Abraham Lincoln and USS Arlington, and they are currently stationed in the northwest part of the Arabian Sea. These aircraft carriers and the battle groups, they have been stationed close to the Strait of Hormuz, which is a strategic choke point. So if Iran tries to impose a naval blockade at the Strait of Hormuz, or if it plans to attack the ships which are passing through Strait of Hormuz, then this could result in a direct conflict with the American forces. Plus, the US has a very strong military presence in various Middle Eastern countries which literally surround Iran. The US already has a strong military presence in Iraq, Qatar, Bahrain, Kuwait and UAE. And thousands of troops have already been stationed in these military bases. And the Pentagon plans on deploying an additional 120,000 strength of troops to deal with any possible conflict with Iran. So there is a greater responsibility on the European countries in order to ensure that the US does not resort to yet another misadventure similar to the illegal invasion of Iraq in 2003. Now, before we take up the practice questions, we have a small correction with regard to yesterday's news analysis. Yesterday it was mentioned that the Bhima River is a tributary of the Godavari River. This is incorrect, so we regret the factual error which was made. Please note down that the Bhima River is a tributary of the Krishna River. Now let us take up the practice questions for today. Wayanad Wildlife Sanctuary is a part of the Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve. So option B is the correct answer. Now let's look at the next question. Which of the following statements is or are correct? Hemophilia A is a genetic disorder which prevents clotting of blood and results in excessive bleeding. It usually affects males more than females. Both the statements are correct, so option C is the correct answer. Now let's take up the next question. The CRZ notification draws legal mandate from which of the following legislations? The correct answer is option C, the Environment Protection Act of 1986. Now let's look at a map-based question. Which of the following countries are located to the north and south of Strait of Hormuz respectively? The correct answer is option C, Iran and the United Arab Emirates. Please look at this map. This is where Strait of Hormuz is located. And to the north, we have Iran. And to the south, we have United Arab Emirates. Now let's take up a question from the 2015 prelims paper. In which of the following activities are Indian remote sensing satellites used? Is it used in assessment of crop productivity? Or is it used for locating groundwater resources? Or for mineral exploration, telecommunications or traffic studies? The correct answer is option A. The IRS satellites are used for assessing crop productivity, locating water resources and mineral exploration. They cannot be used for telecommunication and traffic studies. So option A is the correct answer. So this concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.